I, Dr. J. Kishore Babu, the convener of the FDP, hereby invite Ms. B. Shanti Sri, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to introduce today's speaker. Over to you, Madam.
Good evening, everyone. Dear participants, it is my honor and privilege to say a few words about today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Y. Aparna, who would enlighten us on the topic, Synthesis and Characterization of Nanomaterials. Madam is the head of the Department of Physics, JNTU Hyderabad. She completed her UG in 1985 and PG in 1987 and PhD in 1992. She has published more than 150 papers in reputed international journals and conference proceedings and authored 3 books. She has been honored with Best Teacher Award by Government of Telangana in 2019. She received many awards from DST under Fast Track SERC, Young Scientist Scheme SRF RA and SRA from CSIR and STA, Japan Institute of Science and Technology. She is working on 3 major research projects worth 110 lakhs funded by UGC. Under her guidance, 12 students were awarded PhD degrees, 3 PhD students have submitted their thesis, and 2 PhD students are enrolled. Her research area of interest are synthesis and applications of nanoparticles. She is a member of ICNB Malaysia and Material Research Society of India. Madam, it is our privilege to have such a distinguished personality like you in our midst to enlighten the participants. Over to you, Madam, to address the participants.
So, shall I switch on video?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, thank you very much, Shanti Sri, for introducing me in a very nice way. Are you able to see me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, first, let me thank organizers of this FTB for inviting me to deliver a lecture. And thank you very much. And I wish it is going on very well. I hope it started from yesterday. It's going on very well. I hope we will conduct this type of FDPs, more FDPs on, in online, so that so many people will get benefit. So this trend really has started a very good trend. At this pandemic situation, this is the best way of improving our knowledge and updated with what is going on. Really, I appreciate organizers for initiation for this online FTP. So already Shanti Sri introduced and about me. So I am the faculty in, I'm a professor and HOD in JNTH College of Engineering. Most of the people are familiar with me. So let us start. I'll share the content and we'll start. Harshi, ఇది డ్రాప్ బాక్స్ సైన్ ఇన్ Sridhar, can you share the content? I had some problem with the Dropbox. Hello, Sridhar?
Yes, madam. I'm doing, ma'am.
Yeah, please share the content. I had some problem with the Dropbox.
Okay, ma'am. I'm doing.
Sir, what is it? Yeah. Thank you, Sridhar, for sharing the content. Thank you very much. I had some problem. Yesterday it was opened. I don't know. Well, today it was not able to open. So my today's lecture is basically on synthesis and characterization of nanomaterials. Basically, we'll concentrate on nanotechnology. And so why nanotechnology? First, we'll address a few things. Why nanotechnology? Why, what, how? We'll try to address. So who, what, why, and how to learn about nanotechnology? We'll start with this thing and we'll understand what exactly nano means. Nowadays, without nano, we can imagine our world without nano. So last 10 years, there is a dramatic change in nanotechnology, research in nanotechnology. And lot of research is going on and a lot of developments are taking place. We are enjoying the benefits of nanotechnology. Last 10 years, it is in the full form. So lot of research is going on. And let us discuss about the beginners who don't know about the, it's a very basic presentation, who can understand very well that what is nanotechnology, basically. And maybe you have to move. I can't, can you go to previous slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so we have covered a little about, we are going to cover what is nanotechnology is, who cares about it, why it is important, when it got started. So but how should we approach this? We'll try to understand all these. Next slide, please. So Richard Feynman, he is a grandfather of nanotechnology. You can imagine that. In 1959 itself, Richard Feynman, he got Nobel Prize in Physics. So one statement given a scope for new field of nanotechnology. So his statement is there is a plenty of room at the bottom. So before that, there was no much idea about the nanotechnology. The one statement changed the world. So an invitation to enter into a new field of physics. So offered $2,000 prizes, build an electric motor in a 1/64 inch cube, that is one, and reduce a page of your book by a factor of 25,000. You can imagine, read using an electron microscope. So 1960, engineer claimed the first prize. 1985, graduate student wrote a page from a tale of two cities, 1/160 millimeter in length using e-beam lithography. So that time, this time $1,000 may not be a big amount, but that time it is a very, very big amount. So it is not newly started, but it started very early. But now we are enjoying the benefits of nanotechnology. Next slide. So what are his predictions? Basically, He's the scientist who got Nobel Prize. So there is this statement become very, very famous. So he gave on December 29, 1959. So what are his predictions? Basically, manipulating and controlling things on a small scale. So next, write the Encyclopedia Britannica on the head of a pin. So how we write small information on a small scale? Better electron microscopes, the marvelous biological systems, miniaturizing the computer. So miniaturization of by evaporation, problems of lubrication, 100 tiny hands, rearranging the atoms in a small world. So all these are predictions. Now almost we are fulfilling all these predictions. So he might have not seen all these predictions, but now we are enjoying all these benefits of these prediction right now. Next slide please. So why nano, what nano, how nano, now we'll try to understand. Next slide. So now what is nano? First we have to understand, so how things will look from 100 meters. So you can visualize how things will be. We at a distance 100, we started from 100 meters, 10 meters, 1 meter, and 10 to the power of minus 1 meter, and 10 to the power of minus 2. It is a more, we are zooming towards a hand basically. So 10 power minus 2 meters and 10 power minus, you can see 10 power minus 3 milli range, you can see very clearly about the hand, the lines on the hand. Next slide. So 10 to the power of minus 4 meters, 10 to the power of how it looks like. We are going to deep, very small scale, 10 to the power of minus 5, 10 to the power of minus 6, minus 7, 10 to the power of minus 8, almost we reach to DNA, and 10 to the power of minus 9 meters. So next slide, please. So universe consists of particles. So particles particles make stars and planets. Particles make bulk materials also, and particles make nanomaterials also. But why nano is important is our present topic. So usually we don't have any application, we don't bother about such type of materials, because we are finding a lot of applications we are more interested, because the human nature had to exploit the nature of the material for the usage of mankind. That is basically our nature. And financially also, it is equally important that. So now we'll discuss one by one. Next slide. So now you see, so when sun is, how small is a small? That is the biggest question. So when compared to universe, I missed one video that was very nice video. It is about the universe. Yesterday I searched a lot, but I didn't find that video. So, but how small is small? First, that is a basic question. So suppose the sun seems to be a very big, maybe 1,000 times, 2,000 times bigger than Earth. But you see, sun before Arcturus. So you see, and how small it is, sun is small. So how many suns could fit into Sirius, Pollux, and this one, very big one. Next slide, please. So now, how many S could fit inside Jupiter, Neptune, and the Sun? So you see, here the Earth is the, you see here it's a point out how small it is. How many S you can fit into a Sun, you can understand by seeing this picture, and by how the magnification will and compare to Sun and Earth. So next slide, please. So small is small. So now see 100 nanometer, comparing 100 nanometer to the size of a soccer ball is like comparing a soccer ball to the size of the Earth. Just for the comparison, this picture was given. Next slide. So how small is nano? So this is the finally definition of a nano. 1 nanometer is 1 billionth of a meter. It is 10 to the power of minus 9 meters. So then we call this as nano. Is approximately width of 4 to 5 hydrogen atoms. So a human hair, it is comparison only I'm giving. A human hair is approximately 80,000 nanometers wide. A red blood cell approximately 7,000 nanometers wide. So next slide, please. So why nano? So why we are interested? So basically we'll try to understand that. Recognition of size dependent. There are two reasons why we are interested in nano. First one is recognition of size dependent properties of material added with advanced improvements in technology. That is the first reason. Next, nature selection of adaptability, energy saving, and survivability. These two reasons made us nano very, very attractive. So this is like a body mass of a beetle, fly, maybe spider and gecko. It is given just for your information, how it will be, like comparison purpose. Next. So things, what are natural? This scale of things, nanometer and more. So here it is given. So how we can understand how nano will be? So now here things man-made is on the right side. Things naturally will be on left side. You see that how many of naturally available nano are there. So fly ash and red blood cells and of course DNA and some other things. These are the naturally in the nano form. So things man-made, head of your pin, these are the given carbon nanotubes and other things, lithography made patterns, all these are nanoscale. Man-made versus things what we get natural. Next slide. So history of nanotechnology. First example, this Lycurgus cup is a Roman artifact from before 640 AD. So it changes colors when illuminated from the inside. This effect is caused by gold and silver nanoparticles and was likely produced by accident. They might not be knowing that. So they are they synthesize nanoparticles. But later time when they are observing, so they found that nanoparticles in that in this cup basically. So next, it's a very interesting. So next, history of nanotechnology, stained glass. As early as 500 AD, glass artisans were making stained glass windows with vibrant reds and yellows. These colors were much more luminous and durable than dyes could produce. They were the products of kinage metals. You might mean, the nanoparticles, basically the kinage metal nanoparticles embedded in the glass. You know about the kinage metals. So go to next slide. So the copper, CuAgAu. These three are the kinage metals. So when you go to early ages, we know about the Krishnadevaraya time, we have golden currency, like golden coins as a currency, sometimes silver. Now all those are gone, but now we are using for the ornamental purpose. So now the digital currency or whatever it is, paper currency was come into picture. But as these nanoparticles get smaller, the color shift from red through yellow and green to blue. Here is an example of a copper nanocrystal that is roughly 100 nanometers across. So this is the picture. Next slide. The history of nanotechnology, collides. So they found nanoparticles stay in solution, leading in one of the images, attractive images of the nanotechnology. The rainbow arrow, you can see various colors, like the rainbow arrow solution made by the suspension of variety of size of nanoparticles. So this was discovered by Michael Faraday in 1857. You can see various colors. So next, the nanoparticles were suspended basically. So now what is the difference between nanoscience and nanotechnology? So nanoscience is the study of phenomena and manipulation of materials at atomic, molecule and macromolecular scales, where properties differ significantly from those at larger scale. So nanoscience is the our part, which physicist will take care of nanoscience. So we'll try to find what are the properties of particles, how to characterize them, and how to synthesize in a small scale and a large scale. All these are the challenges of a physicist. But what about the nanotechnology? Nanotechnologies are developing the technology is the duty of the engineers. So nanotechnologies are the design, characterization, production, and application of structures, devices, and systems by controlling shape and size at nanometer scale. This is the difference between nanoscience and nanotechnology. Next. So it already we have discussed a nanometer is 1000 millionth of a meter. People are interested in the nanoscale because at this scale, physical and chemical properties of materials differ significantly from those of larger scale. Otherwise we are not at all interested in nano. So we'll get some attractive properties in the nanoscale. That is why we are more interested in them. So next slide. So what is nanomaterial? It is defined as any material that has unique or novel properties due to the nanoscale. So structuring, such type of materials are called nanomaterials. These are formed by incorporation or structuring of nanoparticles. Next. So nanomaterials, so what is the novelty? Most of them are novel. So nowadays, whenever people are working for PhD, so first person the examiner is going to ask is, what is the novelty in your technique or novelty of your work? That's the very frequently asked question. So this is why nano are novel. So this is very, very important for us to know about what is the novelty. New forms of existing materials with characteristics that differ significantly from familiar or naturally occurring forms. Nanomaterials can have 1, 2, or 3 dimensions in the nanoscale. That is the beauty of the novelty of these nanomaterials. Next slide. So now nanomaterials can have a category of nanomaterials, and examples here is clearly given. Nanomaterials can have 1, 2, or 3 dimensions in the nanoscale. One dimension nanomaterials, the examples are layers, multi-layers, thin films, platelets, and surface coatings. They have been developed and used for decades, particularly in the electronics industry. Next, two-dimensional materials, nanowires, nanofibers. When you reduce one more dimension, they'll become two-dimensional nanowires, all these carbon nanotubes and a subset of this group and carbon nanotubes. Three-dimensional are known as nanoparticles and include precipitates, colloids, and quantum dots, tiny particles of semiconductor materials and nanocrystalline material. We'll try to learn. It's very difficult to learn about all these materials, but as far as some interesting research and some interesting properties, I'll try to share. So otherwise, if you concentrate on this, then it will become a more than 2 hours lecture. So another one. So based on the size and shape, so the nanomaterials are classified as nanoparticles, nanocapsules, nanofibers, nanowires, fullerenes, nanotubes, nanosprings, nanobelts, quantum dots, and nanofluids. So here we are going to discuss about fullerenes and quantum dots in more detail. Rest of the things, if you understand one thing, it is the same for everything. Next slide. So what is a fullerene? So a fullerene is any molecule composed entirely of carbon. It consists of only carbon in the form of a hollow sphere, ellipsoid, or tube. Spherical, here it is given C60 in solution, how it looks like. So these other forms also given. Spherical fullerenes are also called buckyballs, and cylindrical ones are called carbon nanotubes or bucky tubes. Next slide. So photograph of the research group that discovered the fullerene at Rice University in September 1985. So these are the details about Nobel Prize in 1996, so that we'll have developed some interest. That's why I'm sharing. Next one. So allotropes of carbon. So you know that we know that graphite and diamond both are derived from carbon. So different structural modifications of an element, the atoms of the element are bonded together in a different manner. So diamond, hardest and natural mineral, graphite, dry lubricant and graphene, amorphous carbon, coal and soot, fullerene family, C60 carbon nanotubes, etc. Diamond and graphite are two allotropes of carbon, pure forms of the same element that differ in structure. You know that graphite is having layered structure, and you know about the structure of a diamond. So entirely they are showing the opposite. The diamond is such a bright and everyone likes, and graphite, of course, it looks like black, but it's very useful in pencil lead and for other things it can be used. Next slide. So naming fullerene, the substance of the fullerene was named after the American inventor. So it was named after R.B. Fuller, designed the constructions which exist 5 corners and 6 corners, for example, like American Pavilion to the Expo in 67. These are the more details was given about fullerenes. Next slide. So various fullerene molecular models, C56 to C76, how it looks like. If anyone is interested, just you can have more details. So just I gave the structures. Next slide. So fullerene reaction, what are the possible reactions? So C60 and C70 to a lesser extent may undergo additions, polymerizations, substitutions also possible. So this is a complete, the picture was a brief idea about how it can be reacted. Next one. So now I'll come to quantum dots. I told you that I discuss only about these two, quantum dots and fullerenes. Quantum dots are basically, they called as QD, are nanoparticles structures that exhibit three-dimensional quantum confinement, so which leads to many unique optical and transport properties. Here we learn about what is why they exhibit different properties when go to the small scale. So these are the quantum confinement is one of the reason. Now we'll discuss about what is quantum confinement and what is surface to volume ratio. These two makes nano differ from the other materials. Next. Quantum dots are usually regarded as semiconductors by definition. Similar behavior is observed in some metals also. Therefore, in some cases, it may be acceptable to speak about metal quantum dots. Typically, quantum dots are composed of groups 2 and 6, 3 and 5, and 4 and 6 materials. So quantum dots are band gap tunable by size, which means there is a lot of scope for new materials with various properties. Basically, we can tailor the band gap of quantum dots. So which means their optical and electrical properties can be engineered to meet specific application. When you able to tailor the band gap, we can tailor optical properties basically. So that is the beauty of these quantum dots. Next slide. So next, what is quantum confinement? I already told you, quantum confinement is one of the reasons. So that makes nanomaterials unique. So first we should know what is quantum confinement. Quantum confinement is the spherical confinement of electron hole pairs, are called, in brief, they are called excitons in one or more dimensions within a material. So one-dimensional confinement, quantum wells, two-dimensional confinement, quantum wire. If it's three-dimensional confinement, we call it as quantum dot. We'll discuss more about in detail. quantum confinement is more prominent in semiconductors because they have an energy gap in their electronic band structures. Metals do not have band gap. We are aware of this. That is why so quantum size effects are less prevalent. Quantum confinement is only observed at dimensions below 2 nanometers. Next slide, please. So this is given the bulk material made thinner and thinner until the electrons can move only in 2 dimensions instead of 3. Then it is called 2D quantum confinement. Next level is quantum wire, ultimately quantum dot. You can define in that way. Here it is given how the quantum well, it will be electrons, they mapped quantum wire, how it will be. You see quantum dots, how it looks like. Next slide. So what do you mean by nanoparticles? Nanoparticles are the particles of size between, this is roughly we can like 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. It depends on the application also. We can call it even thin film also. For some, we can't mention that only this thin film is a thin film like that. There is still the argument is going on. But broadly, we can say nanoparticles are the particles of size between 1 nanometer to 100 nanometers. 1 nanometer is only 3 to 5 atoms wide. So 40,000 times smaller than the width of an average human hair. But comparison I am giving. So already the size of hydrogen is, just for the comparison, I have given hydrogen atom and protein and what is the computer chips and diameter of human hair. That's why we are able to see it is a 10 micrometer. You can imagine comparison purpose idea. At the nanoscale, the physical, chemical and biological properties of materials differ in fundamental and valuable ways from the properties of individual atoms and molecules or bulk matter. Next slide. So why nanoparticles? So what are the applications basically? So nanoparticles are of interest because of new properties such as chemical reactivity and optical behavior that they exhibit compared with the larger particles of the same materials. For example, titanium dioxide and zinc oxide become transparent at the nanoscale and have found applications in sunscreens. They may not show that property when it is in the bulk. When it goes smaller and smaller in size, and it changes its properties basically. Nanoparticles have a range of potential applications. Unless we don't have application, we are not at all interested. That we find a lot of applications, that is why we are interested. In the short term applications such as in cosmetics, textiles and plants, in the longer term applications such as drug delivery, where they could be used, delivered drugs to a specific site in the body. Lot of research is going on. Without doing any damage to other parts of the body, so wherever the ill cells are there, they can deliver at that parts. Next, nanoscale effects on properties. Catalytic, you will get better catalytic efficiency through higher surface to volume ratio. Electrical, interested electrical conductivity in ceramics and magnetic. So we can tailor the electricity or conductivity because all those are band gap related phenomena. So we can tailor the electrical conductivity so that they can be very useful in microelectronics basically. Magnetic, increased magnetic coercivity up to critical grain size, super paramagnetic behavior. Next to mechanical, improved hardness and toughness of metals and alloys, ductility and super plasticity of ceramics. Next, optical, spectral shift of optical absorption and fluorescence properties, increased quantum efficiency of semiconductor crystals. Next, spherical, increased selectivity, hollow spheres for specific drug transportation and controlled release. Next, biological, increased permeability through biological barriers, membranes, blood-brain barriers, improved biocompatibility. All these are the effects. Nanoscale effects on properties. So we can get improved properties basically. Next. So size range of particles. So I told you two main reasons for this change in behavior at nanoscale, an increased relative surface area, and dominance of quantum confined effects. We have already discussed of quantum confined effects. Now we'll discuss about the how the surface area is going to affect. Next. Increase in surface area to volume ratio. This is a very, very important. It's a bit confusing, but if you understand this, then you will understand why they are showing different properties. Nanometals have a relatively large surface area when compared to the same volume of the material produced in a larger form. Let us consider a sphere of radius r. Then its surface area is 4 pi r square. Its volume is 4 pi. These formulas you know. Surface area to its volume ratio is, suppose if you substitute area to volume ratio, you will get basically a precise form 3 by r. Thus, when the radius of the sphere decreases, its surface area to volume ratio increases. Because r is in the denominator, r reducing means your area increases. Consider one cubic volume, its surface area is 6 meter square. When it is divided into 8 pieces, its surface area becomes 12 meter square. When the same is divided into 27 pieces, its surface area becomes 18 meter square. Thus, we found it is given volume is divided into small pieces, the surface area, but volume is constant. Hence, particle size decreases, a great proportion of atoms are found at the surface compared to those inside. That is the main point we have to note down. More particles will be, that is why catalytic activity will increase because of this. Next. Next slide. So this is a pictorial representation of V is equal to surface area. Notice the difference in powers of linear dimension in the ratio of surface area to volume ratio. So how it breaking the large, like the total volume the same into smaller cubes, keeps the total volume same, but we cut into small pieces. Next slide. So surface area increases while total volume remains constant. This is given, like the, how it, it's a one fine, and how it is, when you cut into small pieces, how it looks. Next. So here it is given, radius 1 centimeters, what will be your surface to volume ratio. And if it is 2 centimeters, you see here how it is varying. For example, only for calculation. Next slide. So these are so some other information regarding quantum confinement effects. When atoms are isolated, the energy levels are discrete. When very large number of atoms are closely packed to form a solid, the energy levels split and form bands. Already you might have learned about this. Nanomaterials represent intermediate stage. Consider the problems of particles in a potential well as well as in the potential box. The dimensions such wells are boxes are of order of de Broglie, wavelength of electrons are mean width of electron, energy levels change. This effect is called quantum confinement. And the material is sufficiently small size, typically of 10 nanometers or less, organization of energy levels into which electron can climb or fall change. Specifically, the phenomena results from electrons on and holes being squeezed into dimensions that approaches a critical quantum measurements called the excitation Bohr radius. These can affect the optical, electrical, and magnetic behavior of the materials. How it is going to, it was clearly given in this slide. Next slide, please. So more mechanical, optical, magnetic, electrical, and chemical characteristics of nano-sized materials depend not only on type of material, but very much also on their size and shape. By nanotechnology, the light yield of semiconductors can be increased drastically. Light is to be produced efficiently and in a pleasant color from semiconductor material, which has the benefits of conventional light sources. Next slide. So in materials, where strong chemical bonding is present, delocalization of valence electrons can be extensive. The extent of delocalization can vary with the size of the system. Structure also changes with size. The above two changes can lead to different physical and chemical properties depending on size. Optical properties, band gap, specific heat, and surface reactivity. Even when these are consolidated into macro solids, new properties of bulk materials also possible. Example, enhanced plasticity. Next slide. For semiconductors such as zinc oxide, CDS, and silicon, the band gap changes with size. When the band gaps lie in the visible spectrum, a change in band gap with size means a change in color. For magnetic materials such as ferrous, cobalt, nickel, Fe3O4, etc., magnetic properties are size dependent. The coercive force or magnetic memory needed to reverse an internal magnetic field within the particle is size dependent. The strength of the particle's internal magnetic field can be size dependent. Color. So these are the properties which are going to affect because of this nano size. In a classical sense, color is caused by the partial absorption of light by electrons in matter, resulting in the visibility of the complementary part of the light. On most smooth metal surface, light is totally reflected by the high density of electrons, no color, just like a mirror-like appearance. Small particles absorb, leading to some color. This is size-dependent property. Example, gold, which readily forms nanoparticles, but not easily oxidized, exhibits different colors depending on the particle size. So gold colloids have been used to color glasses since early days of glass making. Ruby glass contains finely dispersed gold colloids. So silver and copper also give attractive colors. Already we have discussed about these kind metals. So using nanotubes, a carbon nanotube between electrode spaced 500 nanometers. So it is. It looks like it was given in this slide. Next. So nano in nature. The natural world also contains many examples of nanostructures. Milk. So do we know that milk is also a nanoscale colloid? So nanostructured proteins that control a range of biological activities such as flexing muscles, releasing energy, and repairing cells. So nanoparticles occur naturally, have been created for thousands of years as the products of combustion and food cooking. Next. So like a fly on the leaf, 1 centimeter. So again, this size dependent. Next slide. So the fly eye is made up of hundreds of tiny facets resembling like a honeycomb. So 100 meters, like 10⁻³ meters, how it looks. Next. So this is 10⁻⁴ meters. So you see how each facet is a small lens with light sensitive cells underneath. Imagine this is an electron microscope picture. This is. Next. So this is a 1⁻⁴ in between the facets are bristles, which gives sensory input from the surface of the eye. 10⁻⁶ meters for the enlargement of the bristle. Next. 10 nanometer size. So regarding fly eye, we are going deeper into deep, 10⁻⁸ meters. At the center of the cell is a tightly, so how it looks like DNA, so we can clearly visualize. Next. So 1 nanometer, how it looks like. So fly eye. Next. So, yeah, you see that atom 0.1, a perspective. Atom 0.1 nanometers, DNA width 2 nanometers, protein 5 to 15 nanometers, virus 75 to 100 nanometers, materials internalized by cells less than 100 nanometers, bacteria 1000 to 10,000 nanometers, white blood cells 10,000 nanometers. Next. Next slide. So they have a fluorescence at different wavelengths from a single UV light due to quantum confinement in semiconductor quantum dots. So this is given. So next. Understanding effects. At centimeter, so gravity, friction, and combustion will dominate. Next millimeter, gravity, friction, combustion, and electrostatic are more dominant. Micrometer, electrostatic, van der Waals, and Brownian effects are more dominant. Nanometer, electrostatic, van der Waals, Brownian, quantum. These effects are dominant at that nanometer level. So angstrom, only quantum mechanics will be dominant. Next. Next slide. Next slide. Advantage of bulk solids deform and fail due to motion of dislocations and sliding of grain boundaries. Perfect nanotubes lack these mechanisms and therefore should be strong. Carbon nanotubes are 50,000 times as thin as human hair, as strong as diamond, can hold 100 times the current of metal wires. So this is the advantage of nano. Next. So next, we'll go to synthesis part of the nanometers. So there are two methods. So top-down method and bottom-up method. So top-down method is like destruction and bottom-up method is construction. The top-down method is nothing but you take a big bulk and you cut into small pieces and you grind it, you get the material. Bottom-up is like the chemical methods, you add something or such type of methods are called bottom-up methods. Next. Next slide. Here it is given top to bottom mechanical ball milling, and you see synthesis of nanoparticles, bottom up, top to bottom. So these are the methods: mechanical ball milling, chemical etching, thermal laser ablation, sputtering. So and bottom up, chemical electrochemical precipitation, vapor deposition, atomic molecular condensation, Sol-gel process, spray pyrolysis, laser pyrolysis, aerosol pyrolysis. So green synthesis is through bacteria, plant extract, fungus. So most of the people are working on a non-toxic. These two are toxic because they involve some chemicals and all those. But using green synthesis, one of my students also, she used green methods for the synthesis of nanomaterials. So bacteria, plant extract. She used plant extract to prepare the nanoparticles. Next. So top-down approach. So here in one picture it is given. Top-down approach begins with a pattern generated on a larger scale, then reduced to nanoscale. Relatively expensive and time-consuming technique. The approach uses larger initial macroscopic initial structures. The structures can be externally controlled in the processing of nanostructures. So whereas bottom-up, start with atoms or molecules and build up to the nanostructures. Fabrication is much less expensive, includes the materials component at atomic level, leading to formation of nanostructures. During self-assembly, the physical forces operating at nanoscales are used to combine basic units into larger stable structures. So this is the miniature. So next slide. So here some techniques I have not discussed about all these techniques, but one or two techniques I have given. Bottom up approach, physical vapor deposition involves generation and condensation of vapor phase pieces via thermal evaporation, sputtering or laser evaporation. So this inert gas condensation, the inert gas evaporation condensation technique in which nanoparticles are formed via the evaporation of metallic sources in an inert gas has been widely used in the synthesis of ultra-fine metal particles. So in this process, a metal evaporated inside an ultra-high vacuum chamber filled with inert gas, helium. The vaporized species collide with the helium molecules, thus losing kinetic energy as collisions limit the mean free path. Supersaturation can be achieved above the vapor source. At high temperature supersaturation, the vapors rapidly form number of clusters that grow via so these clusters get condensation on liquid nitrogen cooled surfaces to form nanoparticles. So this is given clearly in this block diagram. Next. So next, the chemical vapor deposition form thin films on the surface of a substrate by thermal decomposition. So it's a toxic will be there, and less purity is also a problem with chemical vapor deposition. Usually performed at high temperatures, can be performed at various pressures and with assistance of plasma. So CVD film grows, source production of appropriate gas, transport of gas to surface, absorption of gas on substrate, reaction on substrate, transport of byproducts away from the, this is a big task nowadays, transport of byproducts. This is now very, very important. Yeah. Next. So next, Sol-gel process is one of the most of the research scholars are using Sol-gel technique. So briefly, I'll discuss about Sol-gel processing. The Sol-gel process is a wet chemical technique that uses either a chemical solution, so a salt short form of solution, or colloidal particles, salt per nanoscale particle to produce an integrated network, gel. So metal alkalides and metal chlorides are typical precursors. They undergo hydrolysis and polycondensation reaction to form a colloid. A system composed of nanoparticles dispersed in a solvent, the salt evolves then towards the formation of an inorganic continuous network containing a liquid phase. Formation of a metal oxide involves connecting the metal centers with MOM and hydroxo bridges, therefore generating metal oxo and metal hydroxo polymer in solution. After drying process, the liquid phase is removed from the gel. Then a thermal treatment, maybe a calcination basically, may be performed in order to favor further polycondensation and enhance mechanical properties. Next slide. So the block diagram is given of a Sol-gel process, how it happens. So this is the solution, metal oxide solution, hydrolysis, polymerization, now solution, spinning, and so this is a wet gel and evaporation and dense ceramic. How you get is given here, aerogel and next slide please. So ball milling, top down is example is ball milling. It is widely used in industry. If you want a large scale, so this is the best technique. It's a more affordable technique, and you will get in previous technique the product what you are getting is in a very small scale. But if you really wanted for the industry purpose, ball milling is the best method you can get. But those techniques also having its own advantages. And this technique is having its own advantage. Ball milling is a method of production of nanomaterials. This process is used in producing metallic and ceramic nanoparticles. These mills are equipped with grinding media composed of gold frame carbide or steel. Ball mills rotate around a horizontal axis, partially filled with the material to be ground plus the grinding media. Next. So how it works, it was a ball milling was given here. Next. So the significant advantage of this method is that it can be readily implemented commercially. I already told you that it is for the industrial purpose. Ball milling can be used to make carbon nanotubes and boron nitride nanotubes. It is preferred method for preparing metal oxide nanocrystals like cerium and zinc oxide. Next slide. So now these are the characterization of nanomaterials. The preparation is one part, and now you have to characterize the nanomaterials. Then only you will understand which nanoparticle can be used for which purpose. The characterization is very, very important of nanomaterials. Here I haven't discussed thoroughly. It will become another talk. I was discussed briefly. I'm giving. So TEM is the very heart of the measurements. If you want to confirm TEM, so if you want to, when you prepare a material, whether it is in the nanoform or not, it is a very, very important doing the TEM measurements. So TEM will exactly will give you how much size the nanoparticles are there. So XRD will give you the structure of the nanopowder or nanomaterial, and STM will give STM and AFM will give some other roughness and all these measurements. And Raman spectroscopy, it also give good information regarding the nanomaterials. Next slide, please. So scanning electron microscope, I briefly discuss about these instruments, so then we'll go to applications part. Scanning electron microscope uses a focused electron probe to extract structural and chemical information point by point from a region of interest in the sample. So the high spatial resolution of SEM makes it a powerful tool to characterize a wide range of specimens at the nanometer to micrometer length. It can't be used for the nanoscale, but how the structure is morphology and everything, this information will be given by using scanning electron microscope. Next. So this is the block diagram was given, how it works, vacuum pump, electron gun, anode, aperture, condenser lens, and like each one will have its own advantage. It is given here, and what are the each part will how it will work, X-ray detector, secondary electron detector, and sample. Usually some will be attached to ADAX. So ADAX will give you basic the stoichiometry measurements. Next. SEM is the one of the most versatile technique and can be used to image morphology of samples, image compositional and some bonding differences, examine wet and dry samples while viewing them only in ESEM, view frozen materials in SEM with a cryostage, generate X-rays from the samples for microanalysis, view map grain orientation, crystallographic orientation, and study relation to the all these measurements will be given. Next. So transmission, I already told you, transmission of electron microscope is very, very important. The original form of electron microscope, basically it can be used for to determine the size of the nanoparticles. So here it was given clearly how it works, and you can easily find out the size of the nanomaterial. Next slide, please. So here how TEM will work. Tungsten filament generates a beam of electrons that is then focused onto the specimen by the condenser. So the magnetic lenses are used to focus the beam. The column containing the lenses and specimen must be under high vacuum to obtain a clear image, because electrons are deflected by collisions with the air molecules. Magnetic lenses from the enlarged visible image of the specimen on a fluorescent screen. So you can take a photographic film. The screen can also be moved aside and the image captured on photographic film as a permanent record. This is all about TEM. Next. TEM application. A transmission electron microscope is ideal for the number of different fields such as life sciences, nanotechnology, medical, biological, and material research, forensic analysis, gemology and metallurgy, as well as industry and education. TEMs provide topographical, morphological, compositional, and crystalline information. The images allow researchers to view samples on a molecular level, making it possible to analyze structure and texture. This information is useful in the study of crystals and metals, but also has industrial applications. TEMs can be used in semiconductor analysis and production of thermal chips of computers and silicon chips. So this is a scanning tunneling microscope. The scanning tunneling microscope was developed by scientist at the IBM Research Laboratory in 1982. They won Nobel Prize in 1986. Next slide. So concept, a map of the surface can be generated with the resolution in the order of atomic distance. Basically, it will contain a tip. The basic idea is to bring a fine metallic tube in close proximity, a few angstroms to a conductive sample. By applying a voltage between the tip and sample, a small electric current can flow from the sample to the tip or reverse, although the tip is not in a physical contact with the sample. This phenomena is called electron tunneling phenomena. The exponential dependence of the tunneling current on the tip to sample distance results in a high vertical resolution. Next. So this is how it works. So this is the tip and the sample, and there will be electron will transfer from tip to material. Tunneling of electrons takes place. Next. So this is the more detailed how SEM works. It is a piezoelectric tube with the electrodes. And the tip is here. This is the control unit. And this is the sample. The current will be, the electrons will pass from sample to tip. That gives the more resolution view of your sample. Next. Next slide. So next, finally, we come to applications of nanotechnology. So this is the most important, interesting part of this presentation. If you know the applications, then you will be more delighted. How might nanoscale science and engineering improve our lives? So this is a very, very important. Next. So this is the, you might be knowing this application circle, like nanoparticles. So it is more industrial applications, industrial, electronics, environment, renewable energy, textiles, biomedical, healthcare, food and agriculture. So each one, how it works, it is a further it is anti-stain textiles, how it is more clearly here it is mentioned. Here we'll discuss about a few applications. Next. Semiconductor devices in nano domain, you know that how the computer science was reduced, you know about, you think about 10 years back and now how it is reduced. Miniaturization worked with these nanoelectrons. Nanomaterials, nanostructured materials with unique chemical and physical properties, we are able to fabricate new materials for new applications and are effective applications. Nanobiotechnology, interfacing frictional biological molecules and devices with available physical materials and devices. Further nano world, DNA engineering. So this is some more development is expected here. DNA engineering, engineering the DNA molecules to suit the applications. Carbon nanotubes, single-walled or multi-walled carbon nanotubes can be carefully designed to use them in nanoelectronics for spin protection, non-wet suits and non-wet suits and many more. Next. Next slide. CNT-based biosensor. Interest to develop sensors for astrobiology to study origins of life. CNT through INET can be functionalized at the tip with a probe molecule. Current study uses AFM as an experimental platform. The technology is also being used to develop sensors for cancer diagnostics. Identified probe molecules that will serve a signature of leukemia cells to be attached to CNT. Current flow due to hybridization will be through CNT electrode to an IC chip. Prototype biosensor can be developed. This is given. Next. So potential impacts of nanotechnology. Materials, stain resistance clothes, like chemical and biological sensors, drugs and delivery devices. So technology, better data storage and computation. Environment, clean energy and clean air. So the thin layers of gold are used in tiny medical devices. Next, carbon nanotubes can be used for the hydrogen fuel storage. Possible entry points for a nano medical device. Next slide, please. Next, stain resistant clothes. It's a very, very interesting. So when people are becoming more busy and busy, this will be very useful for the people. Nanofibers create cushion of air around fabric. 10 nanometer carbon viscous bond with cotton acts like a peach fuzz. Many liquids roll off. So even though, suppose by chance we are wearing the tea or juice or sauce, if it is spilled on, it may not stick to that. Nano pants that refuse to sail, liquids bead up and roll off. So nano care fabrics with water, cranberry juice, vegetable oil and mustard after 30 minutes and wiped off with wet paper towel. So it's a very, very interesting, right? You see here. Yeah, next. Next. Next slide. So paint that doesn't chip. Protective nanoprint, nano paint for the cars. Water and dirt repellent. You no need to hire a person to clean your car. So it is automatically, it will clean itself. Resistant to chipping and scratches. Brighter colors, enhanced gloss. In the future, could change color and self-repair. So Mercedes covered with a tougher shiner nano paint. Here it is shown. Next. So paint that cleans air. This is very interesting. Nano paint on buildings could reduce pollution when exposed to ultraviolet light, titanium dioxide, TiO2. Nanoparticles in paint break down organic and inorganic pollutant that wash up in the rain. It's a very, very interesting. Like cities like Delhi and all those, they need this type of Mumbai, they need this type of buildings so that the pollution, people are suffering because of the pollution. Yeah, buildings as air purifier. So this is interesting. It's a future development. Maybe it can be, they can develop. Next slide. Nanosolar cells. Nanosolar cells mixed in plastic could be painted on buses, roofs, clothing. So solar becomes a cheap energy alternative. Still, solar energy is not that much cheap. If you want to be in affordable stage, you have to reduce the size and it should give more efficiency. A lot of research is going on in that direction. Next, a DVD that could hold a million movies. It's a very interesting for young people. So current CD and DVD media have storage scale in micrometers. New nanomedia made when gold self assembles into strips on silicon has a storage scale in nanometers. That is 1,000 times more storage each dimension, length, width, or times greater storage density in total. Next. So building smaller devices and chips, nanolithography by to create tiny part, patterns, lay down ink atom by atom. So Mona Lisa, 8 micron tall, created by AFM nanolithography. Transporting molecules to a surface by dip pen nanolithography. Healthcare, nerve tissue talking to computers. So these are all the future developments. Neuroelectronic networks interface nerve cells with semiconductors. Possible applications in brain research, neurocomputation, prosthetics and biosensors. So snail neuron, here it is given in the picture. A snail neuron grown on a chip that records the neuron activity. Next. Healthcare, detecting diseases earlier. So it makes, it's a very, very important. If you if you detect early, then it will be more easy to cure. Quantum dots glow in UV light, injected in mice, collected in tumors, could locate as few as 10 to 100 cancer cells. So here it is given, early tumor detection studied in the mice. It is given here, colors. Quantum dots, nanocrystals that contain free electrons and emit photons when submitted to UV light. Next. Almost we are coming to an end. Healthcare, growing tissue to repair hearts. All these are future applications. Nanofibers help heart muscles grow in the lab. Filaments instruct the muscle to grow in an orderly way. Before that, fibers grew in random directions. Cardiac tissue grown with the help of nanofiber filaments. Here it is given. Next slide, please. Preventing viruses from infecting us. Maybe this much, if it is developed now, it could be very useful for us. No need to use masks or all these things. Nanocoatings over proteins and viruses could stop viruses from binding to cells, never get another cold or flu. Like it is given. It's a very, very relevant slide to the present situation. Next. Nanorobots are imaginary, but nano-sized delivery systems could break apart kidney stones, clear plaque from blood vessels, ferry drugs to tumor cells. So this is all the all our future developments. But near future, definitely, when Godfather of nano, he never expected. He made few predictions, all come to true. But these are also near future. They are going to fulfill. Next slide. Concept video from Nokia and Cambridge Nano Science Center. Okay, next slide. All these are future applications. Modern nanotechnology, microelectronics. So the 360 is one of the most preventional microelectron technologies to employ nanotechnology. The method is silicon on oxide, which makes 100 nanometer silicon layers. This allows for a decrease in microelectron device size and so an increase of density within a chip. Next slide. So modern nanotech sunblock. This is a very, very useful for people who are having pigmentation and the players, especially when they are playing on the ground. So zinc oxide and titanium oxide, they mix, they can be as sunblocks in a nanoscale. Next. Modern nanotechnology, antimicrobial fabric. So this is a very, very interesting. Most people will have bitter experience with the smell of the socks. So these can be, smell can be avoided by using these type of fabric. Next. Future direction, solar panels. Newer solar panels now incorporate nanocrystalline silicon. This increases efficiency by bouncing the light around. Upcoming solar cells incorporate nanostructures, rod, ribbons of different materials to increase the efficiency of these cells. Next. Yeah, research activities in DNA engineering. So sensors like DNA nanowires, sensors and actuators, understanding of life process, biomolecular chip for analysis, and biomolecular motor, nanotube, and stem cells. All these are future possible developments. Next. So carbon nanotube gears also possible. So all these are future developments. So this is also possible. Next. Yeah, thank you very much for your attention. So I finished my presentation with this. So thank you for your patience.
Excuse me, madam. Can I play the video sent by you, ma'am?
Yeah, one video is there that's a very, very interesting. Please play that video. it's playing slowly, little slowly, no? Yeah. Yeah, so some applications video.
Yes. Madam, this is Dr. Yeah. Patrick from GRIT. We thank you very much for this engrossing lecture on nanomaterials, the classification, properties, application. It will go a long way, madam, not only for the faculty members, but also for the research students.
Yeah, it's a very basic presentation, anybody should understand, basically,
yes,
whether they have background or no background. I prepared in such a way, I don't have much time also.
Yes,
yeah, so thank you anyway.
Just to put it on record, nearly 600 faculty or participants have been listening to your lecture for the past 1 hour.
Oh, great. Great, very great.
Madam, we have some questions to be taken from the participants. Okay, yes, I request you to kindly address those questions.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
But before that, we have a poll question. It is not related to the topic, but for our administrative purpose.
Yeah.
So we request Dr. Sridhar to kindly launch the poll question.
Yeah.
Dear participant, you have about 2 minutes. To answer the poll question. The question is, online teaching is as effective as classroom teaching? Nearly 69% of the participants are polled.
They have to tell why, sir, they have to...
No, we can see it on the screen, madam, that how many have polled and they agree, disagree or don't know.
Okay, they can press? Okay.
Yes, yes. They have the choice to press the multiple choice question.
Madam, excuse me, madam, you are the co-host. You can't able to see the poll on the screen, ma'am. Participants, they can able to see the poll.
Yeah, even I can also see.
Okay, okay, ma'am.
So agree, disagree, maybe you could have given one more option, partially. okay, like that. So they can't say either agree or disagree. Don't know. They most of them they can say only don't my opinion is it's not as effective as classroom teaching. To some extent, it will never give satisfaction to the teacher as well as the it's purely my opinion.
Yes, madam. As the polling also, about 83% are polled. They also say 54% say they disagree with this idea. About 45% say they agree. The polling is still on.
No, basically, the eye contact is very, very important. Basically.
Yes, that is true, madam.
So with your teacher, they'll get satisfaction of the presentation or a lesson, whatever it may be. She can assess and she can modulate herself to such an extent she can. It is like I can't see the participants, so only participants can see me.
Yes.
So yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's purely my opinion.
Patrick sir, now the results are on your screen.
Yes. As of now, we can see 45% say that they agree to this question. 54% say they disagree, and 1% say they don't know the answer to this question. Thank you, participant. As of now, some of the participants have raised their hands. Kindly take the question.
Yeah, sure.
First, we go to Dr. Ramdev. Kindly unmute yourself and ask your question.
Madam, I have two questions. One on based on nanoscience, other is based on relating to nanotechnology.
Okay.
The first question is that I read somewhere that the color of nanoparticles when the size is decreasing changes because of the plasma frequency of the electron cloud that is exposed because of reduced size. Can you elaborate on this?
It is a size of nanoparticles. No, that is the responsible. When the size decreases, it can it changes light color basically. So I don't have much idea about plasma and all those. So because of size, I interpret that the colloid will change the color. Much idea about that that part.
The next participant, Dr. Amit Singh Bal. Kindly unmute yourself and ask the question. Dr. Amit Singh Bal. Next we have Mr. Rajiv Mishram. Kindly unmute yourself and ask the question. You're not coming online. Soumya Ramkumar, kindly ask your question.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
Ma'am, it was very interesting, ma'am. I have one doubt, ma'am.
Sure.
Under flow condition, what will be the durability of the coating, ma'am?
Pardon? Regarding
the under flow condition, ma'am, where can we assess the durability of the coating under flow condition, ma'am? If we
slow condition?
No, ma'am, flow, like water flow, like in pipelines or something like that. Can we check the durability, ma'am?
Regarding which one you are asking?
Hydrogenation of our coating, ma'am.
Which one? Last video?
Yeah, ma'am, regarding that, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that video, I don't have much details about that video. Okay. Interest only, just I played that video.
Okay,
it's Ultratech, maybe I don't know that minute details of the how much size they are following and all those just for interest of the participants, I gave the application in the video.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. J. Ramesh, kindly unmute and ask your question.
Hello.
Yes. Kindly ask your question.
Hello. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes. Good afternoon.
Sir, today lecture is wonderful, ma'am. We have very interesting. So my doubt is, ma'am. So do you have TEM instrument in your lab, ma'am?
So we don't have. Actually, we have basic synthesis. We have some facilities, but characterization will go, and our students will go and characterize in IICT, Hyderabad, Central University are there. That we IICT have gained, you know, very much about. There are a lot of characterization techniques are there in IICT, you know. So they'll go and characterize. And most of our students are part-time. So the only summer they can work. And but unfortunately, in JNT, we don't have, JNT College of Engineering, we don't have much research facilities. I'm sorry to say this.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. B. Satyanarayana, kindly unmute yourself and ask your question. Dr. B. Satyanarayana.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, madam. Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
And yes, speak. We can hear you.
Madam, your presentation is very nice.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah.
Are you able to hear my voice?
Yes, yes.
My question is, what is the challenges and importance of nanotechnology in the present pandemic situation of COVID-19, madam? Can you apply this nanotechnology to COVID-19?
So even for you might have heard about our nano department in IST. They made some sanitizer which can be used in the COVID situation very well. And they in collaboration with some people, our nano. But we are the I am in the physics department. But a nano department in IST, they made some sanitizer collaboration with some people. So sanitizer is the main. Now the vaccine was not developed. So only thing prevention is only thing which is before us. So the sanitizer preparation of sanitizer by using nano particles and including nanoparticles, it is more effective and it is very useful. So already our JNT people, they started collaborating and helping in COVID situation, basically.
Madam, another one more question I have.
Yeah.
The three methods you are using to prepare nanomaterial, that is your bottom-up approach, top-down approach, and green synthesis methods. What is the best method to prepare the nanomaterial?
Voice was not cutting.
Think we are not getting him online. The next participant, Dr. K. Selvaraju, you have been unmuted. Kindly ask your question. Dr. K. Selvaraju.
Yes, sir. Madam, good evening, madam.
Yeah, good evening.
Very nice presentation for the basis of nanotechnology. Excellent, madam.
Thank you.
Madam, size will be reduced, band gap will be increased, I think. Yes, madam? Band gap.
Yeah, we can, there is no such type. We can tailor the band gap. Basically, based on the size, we can tune the band gap, I can say. If there is no such rule, it will size reduced and it, we can't say like that. We can tune the band gap of semiconductors very well. Whatever we want, we can tune.
Okay.
That is the importance.
Thank you.
Madam, there are many more participants who want to ask questions. We will tell them to post the questions to us in conference.
You can give them my mail ID so that I can respond our WhatsApp also. Will be better.
Yes, madam. One last question I will ask a participant. That is... Hello. Mr. B. Rajiv Kumar.
Hello.
Please ask your question. This will be the last question, madam, for the day.
Yeah.
Madam, are you able to hear my voice, ma'am?
Yes, I'm able to hear.
Ma'am, is it possible to use nanorobots to clear tumor or cancer cells in the human body, ma'am, in a controlled manner?
Yeah, but the technology was not developed that much right now. In future, anything possible. You might have seen few predictions he made in the 1950. Most of them are... Now they come to practical purpose now. So in future, maybe next 10 years, we can expect the nano robots can be will be used in medical field.
Okay, thank
we
you.
Have to be optimistic that the research, a lot of research is going on. Definitely, okay, we'll go to go. Yeah, we'll reach.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, participant, due to lack of time, this was the last question that we could take for the day. You can mail your questions to the official mail ID that we have had, and we'll ask madam to reply and we'll get back to you.
So, you can share my presentation also. Video was not played properly. I don't know what is the reason. Some player problem or not. I don't know. We can share those with the participants.
Sure, so that madam. They can enjoy the video. Sure, madam. Once again, I thank Dr. Y. Aparna for sparing a valuable time for us, and also thank all the participants for their active involvement. Dear participants, the feedback for today will be posted both in the chat box and the Telegram group. Kindly reply it today itself. I hope it has been posted in the chat box. I request Dr. Kishore to kindly put the feedback form in the chat box.
Yes, sir. Now it is there on the chat box.
Yes, participants, you can just see it is there on the chat box, and also it will be posted in your Telegram groups.
Yeah.
So with this, I thank all of you. Kindly log in tomorrow at the same time, that is before 4:50 p.m. Goodbye from Team GRIET.
Yeah. One thing I want to tell. Sorry for yes, I had some problem of sharing the content. I don't know. Suddenly it occurred. Actually, I was a bit busy today. Our college was started. I was held up in so many meetings today. So other I didn't check that I can. I thought that directly I can share. Sorry for that.
No problem. It was perfectly synchronized between Dr. Sridhar and yourself, madam.
We really enjoyed the lecture. No, anyway, he is my student. No, he will act according to my instructions. That much I am very much sure.
Yes,
about
yes,
madam.
We all
okay,
enjoyed the lecture.
Thank you. And thank you very much. And very nice meeting. I can see only few people on the screen.
Yes,
thank
because
you very
they,
much.
Yes, madam.
Really, I too enjoyed today. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much,
okay,
madam.
Bye-bye.
Dr. Kishore, please close the meeting.